Okay, so for week 8, we were supposed to cover 3 topics. The first one was use of dummy variable in structural changes. Yesterday, I gave you one example for the Pakistan economy, and then we tried with some data. I didn't ask you to do it, but we just estimated a model in which we use a dummy variable for a structural break. We use a dummy variable which has a value of 0 when it was before the structural period time and 1 when it was the post structural period time. And then we saw the coefficient, that how this coefficient represent the structural break changes. So that was the topic which we covered today. I'm going to talk about use of dummy variable in seasonal data, and then we are going to use a few qualities of that for deseasonalization using sales function. So let me start use of dummy variable in seasonal data. Now, what is seasonal data? Are you familiar? Anyone know the seasonal concept? It's like, think of some products which is being sold, any product which is being sold in the market, there are seasons associated to it. For example, I can give you one example from your own experience. When it's time of admission, when it's time of admission, you will see more people buying books. For example, when the school admission starts, you will suddenly see a sudden change or a sudden rush to the bookstores, to the school uniforms and all that. So that's a kind of a seasonal. And then when the time is over, you will see a smooth pattern. Similarly, you would see products which in certain period become very high because of the weather, because of the some other activities, and then it will suddenly, the demand will be smoothed down for that product. So we call these kind of patterns in the data as seasonality. To put it formally, many economic time series, it's a time series phenomena, so many time series, weekly, monthly, or quarterly, exhibit a seasonal patterns. Oscillation, it's like repeated pattern. Some frequently encountered examples are sales at Ramadan, Eid times, Christmas time in Western world, demand for money by household at a vacations time, demand for cold drinks in the summer, demand for warm clothes in the winter, and the list goes on. So this is all called seasonal. So when you as a manager are working, you have to plan. You have to make decisions. If you are a production manager, you have to plan to produce more in time of high season and produce less in time of a normal season, for example. So it has application. If you are a sales manager, you have to make sure that you have enough supply available for the customers while having a high demand season or being able to retain your customers. So the process of removing the seasonal component from a time series is called deseasonalization or seasonal adjustment. So when we want to forecast a time series that have a seasonal pattern, we need to remove the seasonality from that. But do remember that a time series do vary not just because of seasonality. Seasonality is among three or four more components that cause a time series to change over a period of time. Seasonality is one of that. So in this particular topic, we are just focusing on the seasonality. So we say that when a time series has a seasonal pattern, we can remove that seasonality from the time series. And that process is called deseasonalization of a time series, or you can say creating a seasonally adjusted time series. The resulting series is called a deseasonalized or seasonally adjusted time series, as I mentioned. So when you remove the seasonality, you see a much smoother pattern in that data or in that particular time series. We will see today how it works. I will start with a simple model, use of dummy variable in seasonal data. I can think of a fashion clothes that are very seasonal sensitive. For example, for the girls ki population zyada hai, so would be a good example in the class. The girls are more in both sections. When the seasons change, the clothes fashion change. It's like for the winter, the boys normally have one set pattern compared to the female. So it's a very seasonally sensitive product. So we can make a model in which we think of kind of sales function for the seasonal clothes, and that that model we can construct. Well, it sounds a very complex model, but it's not. Sales is like sales of clothes, and then A is constant, A1, A2 into D2, A3 into D3, and A4 into D4 are three dummy variables. These three dummy variables is for three seasons respectively. So season one, or you can say it's quarter, where I presume that one quarter represent a season. So four seasons or four quarters, and the three dummies. We already said that when you have four categories, you use three dummies to avoid the dummy variable trap. Or if I drop A1, so I can add then D2 as well. So D1 as well, sorry. So this is a sales function in which sale is modeled as a function of three dummy variables, where dummy variables represent different seasons. So if we have some data, we can estimate this model, and we can say that how sale is different in season 2 compared to season 1, in season 3 compared to season 1, in season 4 compared to season 1. So what I wanted to say, that the use of dummy variable helps you to check that seasonal pattern, that how the sales function is varying in different seasons compared to some reference category. Now, with saying all that, this is not the only way to look into the seasonal or deseasonalization or removing seasonality from the time series data. Business quantitative expert, business analytics people, they do some other tools as well to remove seasonality from the seasonal time series. However, econometrician only use this approach, so I will be focusing on that. That approach, the other one, is slightly different, in which they construct some seasonal indices and then they do multiply. Maybe you come across with that in some other course, but that's not in domain of this course, so I will just ignore that. Here we will just focus on the construction of the dummy variable model for a particular series which has some seasonality pattern. So the simple way of doing that is introducing dummy variables for each season. And as we already learned that when you have M categories, you use M minus one dummy variable. So in this, we introduce three dummies for four seasons. Here I wrote D1 is for first quarter and zero otherwise. That's the reference category. So that's why it's not included in the sales function. D2 is one for second quarter and zero is otherwise. Similarly, D3 and D4 for third and fourth quarter respectively. Sale is the real sales per 1,000 square feet of the retail space. Well, this is for the length of the clothes they are selling. We assume that each quarter represent different seasons. So that is a big assumption. We could do that as well, that instead of writing D2, I just write spring, winter, spring, summer, and winter. So that would also work. But it was just for, since we are doing it with the months, so that's why we put quarters in it. Now, there are two tasks for you today. One is this one, task 7.6, in which we are going to use dummy variable for seasonal data. So we have to estimate this model, A1, A2, A3, A4 coefficient, and we need to interpret that. We have a data of clothes sales from some US stores in 1986, first quarter till 1992, quarter four. So this is a quarterly data. Till now, we were using the data which were mostly annual data or monthly data. This is the first time we are using a quarterly data. So do remember that seasonality exists only in quarterly data or monthly data or weekly data. It's not in annual data, because annual data is so big that it kind of absorbs that seasonal pattern. So we have this data, and we are going to estimate this model, and we have to interpret that model. So I would ask you to go to your LMS, download the data file. It's a sales data file. Download it and run this model. And interpret this coefficient. Don't close them. We have to use this further. There are more than these three variables in, or more variables in your data. For time being, ignore other variables. we will need that at a later stage. For time being, we just need D2, D3, D4 and sales. So run a regression model, a simple regression model with that and save the result.
So let me show you how to estimate this regression sale function, which in which sale is function of the three dummy variable. First of all, I will open the sales values in Eviews. I can see that it's from 1982 quarter one till 1992 quarter four. Close this data, and now I'm going to regress this on D2, D3 and D4. The sales variables I will select first, because being dependent, then I will select D2, D3 and D4 respectively. I will open it as a equation just to make sure that this is the model I want to run. So I open it as equation and then I click OK, and here I get the result of this particular model.
Once you do that, you should get a box like this. And you can see the coefficient, you can match the data. Maybe the order of your variables may be slightly different, but for D2 you got 14.69, for D3 you got 27.96, for D4 you got 57.1, and for constant you got also certain value. You can see R square value 0.823, you can see F statistic 37.32, highly significant, and the individual coefficient are also statistically significant. So if we go for the interpretation, so as I told you, the interpretation should be with the reference category. So what is the reference category here? The reference category, G, anyone? May all zero, that would be your reference category. D1 is not there, so make D2, D3, D4 zero, so you are left with D1 only. And that would be equal to which term? 14. When I make D2, D3, D4, 0, yes, and left with what? With the constant. So for the first quarter, it's the constant 73. So the sales in the first quarter is 73. And then I say for D2, it's 14.69 units more for quarter 2 compared to quarter 1. So if you want to calculate the value, that okay, 14.69 higher than quarter 1, but what is the value? So you add 14 with this and you 73.18 plus 14.69, so you get the value for quarter 2. And then this coefficient D3 says that sales in quarter 3 is 27.96 more than first quarter. And if you want to calculate the value, you add this 27.96 with 73.1 at the constant, you get the value for the second quarter. Similarly, for the third quarter, for the fourth quarter, we say, sorry, it was for the third quarter, which I just explained. For the fourth quarter, we say it's 57.11 units more than first quarter. And if you want to calculate the value of the fourth quarter for the sales, it would be 57.11 plus 73. This value of the constant coefficient, and that will give you the value for the fourth quarter. So two things take home from this. First, we can use dummy variables to find the seasonal variation in our data. Secondly, when you estimate the regression having the dummies for each season, you get the coefficients, which tells you how one season having different value compared to the base value. You can interpret that coefficient separately and you can add the constant with it and can tell the numerical quantitative value of that particular season as well. So that was still use of dummy variable for seasons. Now, this is what I have written. You can read it at the later stage. So now, the second part is deseasonalization. So this was just to use dummy variable and know that how a particular season has more or less sales compared to the other seasons. Now we are going to discuss the process through which we can deseasonalize a time series. Or in other words, to remove the seasonality from a time series. So how we can do that? This is a two-step process. In order to deseasonalize the time series, I here wrote, for example, sales. So I'm referring to this particular example as well. We proceed as follows. There are three steps. Please focus on these three steps because you have to perform that. right now. So there are three steps through which we can remove seasonality from the time series or deseasonalize the time series. The first step is we estimate the model and we obtain the estimated value of the dependent variable. Now you already estimate the model. Every one of you, I presume every one of you have estimated the model already. What is the estimated value? The estimated value is when you plug in different values of the variables and calculate the forecasted value for the model. For example, if I go back here, now if I wrote this in a formal way, this particular equation, so I can write sales is equal to 73, I will ignore the points part, plus then 14.69, I will ignore again, D2 plus
27,
D3,
57,
D4. And so I will be plugging D2, D3, D4 values in these one by one, and I will be calculating the sales forecasted value for every D1, D2, D3 values. So that's the forecasted value. So first, you will run the model, and you will estimated value of the dependent variable. You will calculate the estimated value of the dependent variable. That's the first step. Next step is subtract the forecasted value or the estimated value from the actual value of the dependent variable to obtain the residual. Next step, we calculate the error term. So I will write it here, error term. Error, yeah, residual. This is equal to original value minus forecasted value. What was the original value? What is the forecasted value? So you calculate the residual value. Now, that's the second step. In third step, you add sample mean of the dependent variable to residual series to obtain the deseasonalized series. Whatever the dependent variable was, it was sales. So you take its mean value and you add it to the season, the residual series, and the new series is deseasonalized series. So three step procedure. First, run the model and get the forecasted value of the dependent variable. Second, take the difference of the original variable with the forecasted variable to calculate the residual. Then take the mean of the dependent variable and add it to the residual and get the deseasonalized series. Now this is a long process. Those of you who were able to estimate your model, look at the results. There should be one value there which is written as mean of dependent variable. Check there, there should be a value of mean of the dependent variable. So that shows that when you run the model, the mean of the dependent variable is also there. Now, check again the box which you have. There is a box which is with resid. Double click on that. Open it. All of you, open it. Resid file. Did you open it?
Yes.
First value is minus 19.47. 19 point something. That's the, and you look at that series, the values is changing. This is the residual values of this particular model which you run. Whenever you run the model, the residual values get stored in this particular model, in this particular file automatically. But if you run a new model, the new model residual values will be in this file. Now, click on the output window, the output you have. Everyone, make it active. And go to the, there is one, make residual series or generate residual series.
Yes, sir.
Is there any?
Residual.
Click on that, and it is just, yes, ordinary residual series. There is an option. Can you find it?
Yes.
Click on that, make residual. It will give you the residual series. What I wanted to say, whenever you want to generate a residual series for some model, all you have to do is to go to that model top menus and to the tab, relevant tab, and go for generate the residual series. It will automatically give you the residual series. So coming back to the slide, there were two steps. In first, you will needed to have a forecasted value, In second, you needed to subtract the forecasted value from the original to get the residual. You can get that with a single click, either through generating the residual or to going to the result file and have that file and then saving it as a new variable, whichever name you want to give it. Clear?
Yes.
Two steps done. And then the third step is to have the sample mean of the dependent variable, and then have adding that to the residual. Now you have a residual series. When you generate the residual, save it as a residual file or call it residual, whatever name you want to give it, just save it as a separate file. You should have that as a separate file. When you generate residual, it's asking you to give a name. Resid01. I don't know. Maybe I have to show it. First, you were supposed to run sales D2, D3, D4. All these open as a group, as equation. Then run the model. So once you have these results, check the menu here. You can see here, not in this one, here. Under proceed, you can see make residual series. So click on that make residual series. Ordinary, and you can name it resid01, or you can call it residual. Click OK and check the files here. You can see here this file will get generated. So OK, this file get opened, and I can see here this resid01. This is the file. If I keep this open and I open this resid file as well, you can see both are same. It's same. So it's the alternative way of doing it. But do remember, the system file just store the last model residual term. The last model you run, that residual will be there. For example, if now you run a new model, there will be a different residual here. So that's why we need to save this as a separate file. So I will close that system file. I will leave that the resid01 open. Now, the next step was to calculate the mean of the dependent variable. I already had here the mean of the dependent variable. 98.12636. So one way could be that I generate a new variable, which, for example, I can just start object generate series. I call this new variable deseasonalized sales, and that should be equal to resid01, the residual of the model, plus its mean, which was 98.126. So I can just write 198.12636. So it will generate a new series which will have residual, and every residual had added the constant mean value of the dependent variable to it. So that's one way of doing it. I click OK, and it generated deseasonalized sales. That's one way of doing it. Another way could be, I go to proceed, generate series. Where is the generate series? Object, generate series. And then I name it as a mean, which should be equal to at the rate of mean. And that should be sales. So this is asking Eviews to generate a series which should be equal to the mean of the dependent variable. So it will generate a series which every value will be equal to the mean of the dependent variable. And you press OK. Now you can see here, I generated a new series. So that is equal to mean. If I open this, you can see here that the mean value is 98.12636, and you can see the results value as well, 98.12636. So that's a new way of doing it. Again, I will take this new generated mean series and add it to the residual. It will generate the same deseasonalized series. So it's up to you if you want to generate it with the directly adding this value 98.126 directly to the residual, or you generate a separate mean series and then add it to the residual. It's up to you. and then the deseasonalized series is generated. So this is the deseasonalized. Okay, so for deseasonalization, there were three-step procedure. The first was that you need to run the model and estimate the forecasted value, then subtract the forecasted value from the original value, that gives you the residual. So I showed you how in Eviews you can generate the residual directly. And then in next step, you take the dependent variable mean value and add it to the residual series, and you get the deseasonalized series. Now, someone asked me why we are doing that. The major objective for any time series analysis is that we want to forecast their time series across the time. So time series forecasting is the primary objective of any time series analysis. Now, when you want to forecast time series data, there are a number of things that cause the time series to variate over a period of time. One of the major components of that variation is the seasonality. So seasonality, when it's removed, there are three or four more components left in time series which can also be removed and can be individually forecasted. So that helps in forecasting. So that's the major purpose of doing that. Another purpose of this exercise is to let you know that how, when a seasonality is removed, how your original model or the demand or sales could be without the seasonal pattern or without being a seasonal pattern. So this was the three steps. How to do that? We already did that, so we'll skip that because I did that myself, so no need to show it. Now, if you open, all of you who have done it already, select these four variables: year, sales, sale forecast, residual series, and deseasonalized series. You can open it as a group, you will get this data. Instead of opening all the variables, I would advise or suggest open sales and deseasonalized series, these two series, open it as a group. Sales and deseasonalized data, open these two as a group. All of you, and check the value. There will be differences. The value seems of same nature, but there is variation. Sometime it would be higher, sometime it would be lower. So that differences is equal to the seasonal component. If one value is become lesser than the original value, sales is the original value and deseasonalized is the adjusted value, adjusted for seasonal pattern, or we remove the seasonality component in it. If you go for, there is an option in it. I don't know, I have to figure it out. There is an option on top of the group you have opened. If you go to the first menu, there is an option graph. If you go to the graph and click on OK, you can generate this graph. Try it. Yes. Duplicate, duplicate, duplicate. Sales and deseasonalized sale open as a group. If you grow view and graph. Now, this graph has, menu has a lot of options. You can explore it. For time being, we will just stick to the basic option, basic type and line and symbol. You can try with some other options as well, but at this stage, we will just do that. And you can see this graph. Now, if you look at this graph, okay, so two variables, sales and deseasonalized sales. Can you see the difference? The one is with a repeated pattern, that's called seasonal pattern, and the other one is more smoother. So that's the difference between seasonality, when you have a time series with seasonality and when you have a time series without seasonality. So I will switch back to my slides. Seasonalized sales are much smoother than the seasonal sales. Now, there is still some variation. If you see the red line, it still has some up downs. Blue line is seasonal, original variable, which was with seasonality. And we, when remove the seasonal part, we make it deseasonalized. This red line is more smoother. However, it still has some variation. We say that when a time series vary over a period of time, there are a number of reasons for that. The major one prominent one is seasonal. However, there are some more which we call, I have written here, cyclical, trend, and random component. These are the three others because of which a time series varies. There are some analysis in which we separate these components from a time series. It's beyond the scope of econometrics course, so I wouldn't discuss it, but just to give you a hand, a data could be trended. Like over a period of time, it may go upward continuously or going downward continuously. So we say that there is a trend in the data, upward or downward. Similarly, there could be some cyclical fluctuation because of some changes in the economy. The data fluctuate. So that also happens in time series and which reflect these variation then happens because of that. And similarly, there is some random component for which we have no explanation. So all these make explain the entire variation in time series. We just focus on the one small component, which is the seasonality. Now, expanding this further to expanded sales function. So now we can think of another model. I would advise you, all of you, the model you have run, just freeze that model, keep it on the side and close all the groups, everything, and go for a new one, a new model. Now, run a new model with all that dummy variables, but include two more variables, and these two variables are real personal disposable income, RPDI, and consumer confidence index, CONF, consumer confidence index. These are the two more variables that also we think is going to influence the sales. So initially we were just considering the seasonal patterns in sales. Now we are adding more variables to our model. We are refining it. We are expanding our sales function. So the new model is all the dummy variable D2, D3, D4, D1 being rough for reference category, and the real consumer personal disposable income and the consumer confidence. So add these two variables and run the model again. If we run this by OLS, our result improve further as shown on the next slide. You will see that as well, and you can see it on your screen as well. But well, we can ask one more question. When we deseasonalize the sales once again by the same procedure you learned earlier, a question arises, and the question is that seasonality would also be in this particular variable and in this particular variable as well. Like with seasons, these variables may change as well. That variable may also exhibit seasonality. It's not just the sales which varies with the time and having seasonal pattern. What about this variable and this other variable which we added? They may also have a seasonal pattern. So what can we do for that? So a simple answer to that is the approach which we use by adding these dummy variables for seasonality took care of that seasonal pattern in these variables automatically as well. So that's the strength of this using dummy variable for seasonality is in regression analysis that it controls for all these things. There is a theorem which is slightly technical, not much explained in this book. There were some more sources for that, but I just skipped it thinking that it would be then too much. You just keep that in mind that when you add the dummy variable, it just not only cover for the seasonality in the dependent variable, but it also do take care of the seasonality of these variables as well. So you can try the same procedure again, which we have studied early to generate deseasonalized series for this new model. Run this model, generate its residual, add the mean of the residual, the mean of the dependent variable in it, and then graph it, and you can compare the values. It would be deseasonalized, it would be more smoother. But do remember, some people may think, why would we get a different error terms for this model? For this model, we should get different error term because when we were calculating error term, we just had three variables initially as an explanatory variable. Now we have five variables. So this model expands further by adding some more coefficient. If I go to the results of this model on the next slide, this is the result. So 1.5 RPDI minus 152.92 and this CONF. Now you plug in different values of D2, D3, D4 and the other two variables and you get the forecasted value. So the error term would be different than the previous model. So this is for the expanded sale function. To learn from that was that if we add more variable and it has the seasonality part as well, it is covered by the dummy variables along with the seasonality in the dependent variable. This is the data which you will be able to generate if you repeat this process, and this is the graph which you can generate with the sales and with the deseasonalized, with the improved or the expanded sale. So that was all as far as the course was concerned. Now let's talk about your favorite topic, midterm.